Hello and greetings to Ireland. My name is Albert van Weeren. I'm Dutch origin, but I do a bit of modern, different wet agriculture, also called paludiculture, in the northeast of Germany, close to the University of Greifswald. And I have some hectares of cattail, naturally grown, but on formerly agricultural used peatland, which has an accidental rewetting because the dike they constructed new is not watertight. It is made by Germans. The Dutch make watertight dikes. But the good thing is that we already for 5 years now do harvest a cattail stand. And I am very interested in what you can do with cattail. So we tried to make summer mowing, we tried to do winter mowing, and to look what we can do with this biomass. And if there is a market for this biomass, just a small overview. The first thing we started with is this very fluffy stuff. This is a cavity wall installation. So this is very good for prefabricated houses, which you can insulate with this. You can use normal tools. The other good thing is this is also a very good peat substitute for growing medium, which we are working on also with the University of Greifswald. So you can harvest this also and use it for substrate, which is 45 million cubic meters a year only in Europe. So it's good to also change there from peat to something more sustainable. This stuff you can also use for producing fibers. Those pure fibers you can put in these kind of MDF or HDF plating, which is 100% sustainable. There's no binder in there. The microfibrillated fibers we make from the typha and reed can be used to make these plates all without binder, but you can use 40% of stuff in there to change the habit of the plating. This is a license thing. The firm Selfo in Zwet in Germany has a license and knows exactly how to produce these microfibrillated fibers. And the other nice thing is you can also make fish and chips in 50% typha and a bit of straw and a bit of hanf. And there is a big market because we want to get rid of all the single-use plastics. Biomass from rewetted peatland can be a very good product for this because you always have a good harvest when the peatland is wet. And when you have a dry year, your harvest as a rewetted peat farmer will be okay. And then you can chop it. Here we have this plant here, we all know it. Now it's very nice, fluffy inside here. There's a lot of air in the arachim, which makes this good for insulation, but also good for making building walls. This wall is made of layers of typha, binded with magnesite. This is not burning. It's circular, it is bioeconomy, and it's self-supporting insulation. You can make a house of this without a binder or standard construction from wood. So we have a new kind of typha board. And in the end, you can also use the fluffy insulation to put it into a brick or a separation wall. Here on the outside is straw magnesite, on the inside it's typha magnesite. It's a bit heavier, it's not burning, and it can be a separation wall in office buildings. So now my computer is of course full with fluffy stuff, always. Why is this is all already known in a project from the Deutsche Bundesstiftung Umwelt, which was running from 1998 to 2000. This is 20 years ago, and these products are still not on the market. So what is the barrier? The barrier is nobody wants it, because the market is dealt with plastic, styropor, oil-based, and mineral and glass wool. And those guys don't want this, because when we put this on the market, they have to go, and they will go. So you need a bit more possibilities to come onto the bio-based circular building industry market. And you have to change the rules so that it's easier for bio-based products to come on this market. So rules have to be adjusted to these new products. I have to make a fungi test because this is a nature product and it's rotting. Mineral wool doesn't have to make it, but it's rotting exactly as mine. But this one is then good for the compost, and the mineral wool, which is full with black fungi, is a special waste. It's chemical waste. So the market is completely blocked for new bio-based products. You have to change a part of the rules. And the other thing is, the barrier is, it is brings at the moment more money to drain the peatland, because in the cap which is running now, and in the new cap, we know it's since 1 week, farmers get a direct payment on draining of peatland. In the new cap, we, as paludiculture farmers, as wet farmers, we also get it. But we still go on the next 7 years to pay contraproductive subventions, which makes it possible first time to drain the peatland. Without this direct payment, the farmers will tell you 1/3 of their income on the drained peatland will fall away, and it's not more economic viable to produce milk on these fields. Of course, Ireland is very strong in Kerrycult was this once everywhere on advertisement, cheese from real meadow milk. But when you have a carbon tax on solid fuels, and you have a ban on where peat is in Ireland, and you have a ban on smoky fuels, maybe it's better to look at how much carbon is at the milk. There's a possibility to calculate this with a sustainability tool from Friesland Campina, a big retailer or exporter of milk in the Netherlands, 18 billion a year. There is about 1.7 to 2 kilos of milk, of 2 kilos of CO2 to 1 kilo of milk. So you would think that's okay, but the soil-bounded emissions from the peatland are not in there. And when you do calculate them with it, you have about 3.5 to 4 kilos of CO2 on a kilo milk extra. So the biggest flux of emissions is not calculated in this tool. Which means that when you make a kilo of cheese from peatland, there will be 10 liters of milk, which will be somewhere between 40 and 70 kilos of CO2. So is making cheese on peatlands a good idea? No, it's not. And you can earn money with those bio-based products. These fibers have to replace single-use plastic tableware. There's not enough trees in the world to do this with wood fibers. So you need to find other fibers. So there is a market, there is a possibility, but you have to pay the farmers who re-wet, and you have to fade out the payment on farmers who do drain. It's an easy conclusion to say there's a gap in the policy. There's not really a gap in the policy. Everybody knows we have to change something. And the market is this plant, cattail, but also reed. There's a huge possibility to use all the layers, to use the waste. It's a circular economy, it's a bioeconomy. It's exactly that what we all want. And the only thing is you have to come to a bigger factory, Nestlé, for a packaging factory where they use 2,500 tons a year. It's done in Zwolle. They are building a factory, the BioLutions. It's a business who creates single-use tableware from fibers, plant fibers, or agricultural waste fibers. So start producing fibers. So the fiber market has to be pushed. And you can push this to subventions for small factories, which are in between the experimental laboratory things, which we know work, the first very small construction firms who make the construction parts like these Typha magnesite binded fiberboard by hand, And we need a bit of more industrialized small factories who can produce not enough, but enough to try and work with this material in the market and in the housing business. So you need this upscaling, an extra step. And that's where we are now. You need this extra step, and this extra step, you can't ask the economy, make this, build your factory and pay 60% yourself. Because this is at the moment very risky, because there's some legal stuff also. Is this material accepted? Will it have a CE certification in Europe? It's not so sure how to do this, so you need to subsidize for 5 years, 100%, a factory who works on small scale with these fibers. That's the next step where we have to work on. And when you arrange that in Ireland and you explain the milk farmers and the firm Kerrygold, that maybe the packaging of the butter in a cardboard box could be a cattail box, maybe they also like to think about using wet peatlands for producing different things. Thank you. Bye.